I'm Jake Hillman, co-founder of Torah in Motion. We want to welcome everybody here this evening. I want to begin by thanking our host, TanenbaumCHAT, and by thanking our sponsors, Ellie Klein, Miriam Erlichman, and Ruben Klein, for allowing us to host this program. We at Torah in Motion are very proud to be hosting a program of this nature. We're proud of many of the programs, all the programs that we host, scholars in residence, conferences, panels, interviews on a wide variety of topics relevant to us in the modern world. We have over 1,000 of our past programs on our website if you want to download and to listen to them, Divrei Torah, and we have a wide range of activities, and we invite you to join some of our other activities, our trips that you see flyers of on your desk, and just want to welcome you, and really I want to thank you, all of you, for all your encouragement and support over the years. And I'm going to turn over the microphone to Dr. Malamet, my partner in Torah in Motion, and I just make one brief announcement. Of course, if you can all please turn off your phones, and we probably will have questions at the end, but you're going to have to write out your questions and hand them out. So if during the course of the evening, we'll come by at the end, and you have any questions, you want to write them down, we'll bring them up to the panel. Just a logistical note. And enjoy the evening, and thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Elliott Malamet. Tonight's panel is really a follow-up to the one that we ran this past May, which opened up a conversation here in Toronto regarding the place of LGBT individuals in the Orthodox world. And we had really enormous positive response to that program, and I commend everyone to check out the video on YouTube. But there are three differences really about tonight's program from the one in May. First of all, I wanted female participation, which we didn't have in May, so that's the first difference. Second difference is that we had five wonderful people on the panel, but only two were LGBT, and I wanted everyone to be LGBT tonight, and I wanted everyone sort of in a younger demographic. It's obviously a bit of a misnomer, these identity letters, since I don't have anybody up here who is transgender or bisexual, and I do think it's important at some point that such individuals also be part of a public conversation. The logistics this time around were just not amenable to that. And the third difference really is that tonight's conversation is primarily about religion. It's not about identity politics, it's not about Orthodox sociology, though both of those will obviously come into play. One of the central features to me of the modern world is how people negotiate multiple identities and sometimes conflicting identities. And I'm specifically interested in the phenomenology of religious experience. How do you remain attached to Jewish life and observance as an LGBT individual? So Rabbi Kelman alluded to it, but I wanted to repeat, it's a very happy task to thank first and foremost Eli Klein, Miriam Ehrlichman, and Ruben Klein, three truly wonderful, caring people who have sponsored this evening in memory of their beloved parents. May their neshamot have an aliyah. In addition, I'd like to acknowledge my former student, David Klein, who helped me with suggestions about participants, as well as Rabbi Steve Greenberg and Miriam Kabakov for their input. And I want to single out my student Yeshaya Grossman, who's now in medical school in Tel Aviv, for his numerous suggestions regarding the panel. Now, on a personal note, this week is the ninth yahrzeit of my father, Colin Malamet, Colonimus Kalman ben Menachem Nachum. My father was born in Germany. He was sent away as a young teenager to escape Hitler's regime. Subsequently, his father was murdered by the Nazis. And it's worth noting that under the direction of SS Chief Heinrich Himmler, persecution of German male homosexuals was widespread. We don't have precise data on how many gay men were killed in this time period, but we do know on April 4th, 1938, that the Gestapo issued a directive indicating that men convicted of homosexuality could be incarcerated in concentration camps. And between 1933 and 1945, the police arrested an estimated 100,000 men as homosexuals, and possibly between 5 and 15,000 were interned in camps. So may our conversation tonight bring us all merit, and may my father's memory be for a blessing. It's really my pleasure now to introduce our panel in alphabetical order. On the far left here is Andrew Dale, who's a financier turned entrepreneur. He recently founded a fashion brand, Le David. He graduated from the Schulich School of Business in 2009 with an honors BBA, specializing in finance. He's a volunteer with Eshel, which is an American organization which aims to create safe and inclusive spaces for traditional and Orthodox LGBTQ Jews, and has spoken in synagogues on multiple occasions about these issues in the Jewish community, and is on the board of directors of the Toronto Partnership Minyan. Next to me is Gidon Feen, who brought homosexuality to the forefront of his high school Orthodox community in Memphis, Tennessee. Since then, he's continued to champion Jewish Orthodox LGBT causes and rights. He's joined Eshel Speakers Bureau and been invited to speak at numerous universities at Brandeis, Maryland, and other places. He's now in his senior year at George Washington University studying international affairs. He previously worked at the White House and on Hillary Clinton's presidential election campaign. My condolences. On the far right here, Joanna Halpern, who grew up modern Orthodox in Calgary and was one of the few religious Jews in her age group. For grades 11 and 12, she moved to Toronto so that she could attend the Opana High School here and be immersed in a strong modern Orthodox community. After high school, she went on to learn at Midrashat Moriah in Jerusalem for a year. She's now in her senior year of software engineering at McGill and is the founder and president of JQueer, which is a community for LGBTQ Jewish young adults. And next to me is Miriam Herman, who's a native of Toronto. She attended Tiferes Beis Yaakov High School here in Toronto. She's currently an advisor for Jewish women in tech at Yeshiva University, where she's pursuing her master's degree in math. Her research interest is in software, analytic topology, and biblical exegesis. Please welcome our speakers. All right, just by way of introduction, I wanted each of you to talk very briefly about coming out when you became aware of the truth of your sexual identities, but specifically, I'd like you to then address how this affected you Jewishly. Did it begin to alter your attitude to Judaism, to Jewish observance, in what ways and why? And Joanna, we'll begin with you.
Hi. So first I want to start off talking about the impression I was given of homosexuality and Judaism growing up. And basically, growing up, when I'd ask, when we asked the NCSY rabbis about it, the answer was very clearly negative, that it should be treated like something like anger, like an anger issue, that it's not the person at fault, but you have to work to get over it. So that's what I heard from a young age and on. So obviously, it took me a long time to accept that I myself am gay. And I received the same negative feelings attending Olpana, which I loved Olpana, don't get me wrong. But just the sense of this is something not good. So at that point, I knew I didn't like guys romantically, but I justified it by figuring that I just haven't met the right person. It's just not the right moment in my life. When I'm older, I'll like someone. And I had boyfriends. I had one very serious one. But then what happened is about my third year in university, I've been dealing with very severe anxiety, and had gotten to such a point that just doing the simplest acts of just getting up and brushing my teeth, it felt like I was working against a wall. It was like I was pushing against something. And I started seeing a psychologist, because that's not normal, and she helped me realize that I had been trying to be this person that I thought everyone wanted me to be, that I thought who I should be, and included in that is not recognizing my sexuality, but it was in many ways in life that I'm trying to be be who I think is expected from me. So from that, I started questioning everything in my life, analyzing it all, from what I wore, is this reflect who I am, to my values, who am I really? And about half a year later, I finally admitted to myself, hey, I actually really like girls. I have crushes on girls. I don't just admire them. But I still thought, like, okay, I guess that just means I'm bisexual. Great, discovered something new about myself. Until half a year later, I was listening to a podcast, The Joy of Text, and on it, they interviewed someone who's both a lesbian and modern Orthodox. And until then, I didn't think that was possible. I had never met someone like that. I didn't even know it was a possibility. And as she was telling her story, it was like, oh my God, that's me. suddenly I realized I could be both modern Orthodox and gay. And that was just like earth-shattering and really exciting. And I started exploring and going on dates with women, and it really felt right. Like I finally was feeling like, okay, I can accept who I am and like fully be me with all of me, both the Jewish sides and the gay part. So that was a really big deal. Since then, like over time, I actually I don't consider myself modern Orthodox anymore. I still very much care about Judaism, and it's a big part of my life, but that doesn't fit for me. It's definitely brought up a lot of questions in Judaism, but, which we'll get into.
Okay, hi everyone. My family and I, we grew up in a pretty Haredi community. I had a black hat at my bar mitzvah. My father still wears a black hat, and I was wearing a black hat for the first year after my bar mitzvah. And it wasn't until I started seventh grade, when my family moved to St. Louis, that I actually first encountered the word gay. And middle schoolers being middle schoolers, it was used as a slur. So I obviously had no affiliation. I didn't connect with that word. And when I look back now to the pre-seventh grade, when I was in elementary school, when I was younger, and I think about guys or how I was thinking about guys that I found attractive or who I felt a connection to, I would always at the time think, oh, I wish he could be my brother. But then I'd be, wait, you can't kiss your brother. You can't be close to your brother. But there was no other framework that I had aside from the father-son and the brother-brother relationship between men. So in seventh grade, when we moved to the modern Orthodox day school, and when my family became more modern Orthodox, I first encountered this concept of gay. And gay was always the term that my classmates would use for the person they didn't like out on the playground, or the person who was always the goody-goody in class. And it wasn't until about high school when I started to realize and really think that, wait, well, there is this other definition of gay. There are these feelings that I've been having my entire life, and they sort of go along with each other. Gay is what I've been feeling. But I still couldn't reconcile myself with all of this negative connotations that the word carried amongst our classmates. And then also in 10th grade, the principal of the high school that I was at, he gave a lecture or a drasha, I guess, to our class, where he, for an hour, went on how terrible it was to be considered gay, how it's a psychological disorder. He compared it to someone who has an inclination for murder and said that those people should be shamed, we need to put them away, we need to be taking care that they're not in our community. And I was in a very fragile state of mind both throughout his conversation and during that entire year, as I was struggling to define myself both sexually and then also in the context of the religion. And following that year, I transferred to a high school in Memphis, Tennessee, which was where I graduated from, and I ended up coming out at my graduation at party in front of the entire school, and was met with an absolute amount of love and acceptance from my friends and my community. And the journey to get there sort of took me from this confused state of mind to an angry one, where I think we'll likely discuss this further on, but I couldn't fathom how I was feeling what I was feeling while practicing my Judaism. And it came to a head on Yom Kippur, where in the Mincha service, we go over the text, and I was feeling that the entire Yom Kippur, I was apologizing for who I was. I was going down to the very core of who I am and tearing myself apart. And it was only after I came out on my graduation night, where I was met with acceptance and love, that I realized, wait, the Orthodox community is a place that I can be myself. The Orthodox community, with my friends, with the support of my parents, is a place where I'm able to thrive and hopefully continue to live.
Coming out was a process. I'd been dating men, breaking up with them, not quite understanding why I didn't share in their heartbreak. I thought maybe I was incapable of love or something equally horrible. And then when I was 21, a friend of mine was super loud and proud and maybe a little bit brash about being bi, and I thought, okay, we'll give it a shot. And a year later, that girl broke my heart. On my first date with a woman, I referred to myself as gay. I felt very strongly a need to identify in the LGBT spectrum. At the time I was in college, I was writing a lot of poetry about breaking out boxes, and yet I insisted on placing myself firmly inside one. Now I don't identify by those four letters. I'm under a gun, and I need to assert my identity in a way that's that personal. I will identify as Q for queer or questioning. A lot of people ask me what the word queer means, so if that's a question, I can respond to that. But simply, it means that I am my own person with my own path and my own mistakes and my own questions, and everything is, it's my life and my path, and so that's what the word queer means to me. My suggestion for this event, my suggestion was identity matters, or over the rainbow, because those are the things that matter to me, the people, the human beings, the Jewish kids that and teenagers that really need to be safe and that need our support and love and acceptance. And so, and I think that my core identity is my Jewish identity and my being a Jewish woman. But at the time that I came out, it didn't really pose any religious question. I wasn't religious at all. If you ask, I don't know if Rabbi Korobkin is here, but if you ask him or any of my rabbis at Stern or in Israel, my Jewish questions at the time were really much, much, much more intense than who I was dating. So it wasn't a religious question for me. But the only religious question I did have was, if I'm going to date women, do I date Jewish women? Does that matter? And it took me a really long time to answer yes, that it does matter to me. And I felt like there was nobody that I had to talk to about that question, about that struggle. And so it was, if that helps anybody, I'm so glad I could say it. Okay, and one last thing about coming out, and I don't know if there's anybody in this room that's listening or listening online or gonna watch this ever, but the most number one, most important thing about coming out for anybody is to make sure that you're safe. Because I didn't come out to my mom until I was financially independent and paying for everything on my own, because anything can happen. So when I did finally come out to my mom, the first words out of her mouth were, "I love you, and I think you're making a terrible mistake." So, on that note, thank you so much for having me.
Shavua Tov, everybody. I'm a Bal Tshuva, and I actually became religious after I was well out of the closet. I'm 29, and I came out around age 20 to 21, and I became religious in the last 2 to 3 years. And people say, "So you became religious after you came out? Are you crazy?" I say, I am a little bit crazy, but it took me a long time. When I was 18, I did some stuff in the Yeshua Torah community. I went on their Jerusalem Fellowships program. It was my first Shabbos at the Kotel. It was my first exposure to basic Torah concepts. It was an inspiring Judaism. And I played around when I got back from my trip with keeping Shabbat and thinking about a religious life. But subsequently, I started to come out, and I just couldn't reconcile those identities. And so I left. And there were certain things I held on to, like I'd eat shellfish, but I wouldn't eat pork. Like I just held on to that one thing. Or, you know, I was still saying the Shema every day, you know, before sleep. And, you know, when I started to date men, it was like a common thing. I would date Jewish men, but never religious men. And it was like, you can't be religious. You're gay. Why are you saying the Shema before bed? And I ran into resistance, you know, in the secular Jewish community as well as the religious community. And a few years ago, after a number of not so good things that happened in my life, one of the ways I was really connecting was by going to shul. And I was a bit of a shul hopper, like every Friday was a different place. Sometimes I'd go straight from work and my phone was still on, but it was just that little bit of Shabbos that elevated me. And when I turned my phone off after I left, I felt like I was coming down from a high. And so I made the decision that, you know, now that I'm finally comfortable with my gay identity all these years later, it's ironic that that is what grounded me in my Judaism, because being comfortable with myself also allowed me to open my heart to the divine. And I think there's something beautiful in your Judaism that emerges from authenticity.
Okay, Gidon, let's talk about God. Many of us have this some kind of God image in our heads as we grow up, and as adults it kind of morphs into something else. And I'm assuming at some point, given the tension, potential tension between your orientations and the religion, which is an important part of your life, that each of you in your own way has probably asked some version of the question, why did God make me gay? I'm interested, what answers have you developed to that question?
Yeah, I always thought the question should be, why did God make me Jewish, as opposed to gay? but the question I did often ask myself was, why did he make me gay? And towards the end of high school, when I was really struggling and grappling with these dueling identities, I was having a lot of very distraught feelings about God. And I never stopped believing that there was God in Hashem and in Judaism, but I kind of started perceiving him as this vengeful, angry God. And the question, the answer that I really had developed was, well, he made me gay because he's all powerful, and this is a way for him to toy with his creations. He's torturing one of them. It happened to be me. And I'm just kind of stuck in this torturous, horrendous cycle of no escape. And it was this all came to a head on that my Yom Kippur of my last year in high school, when I really was tearing myself apart over how can I be standing here before this God who was just here toying and playing with me and seemingly trying to hurt me. And I think now I absolutely don't view God like that, and I have a very happy relationship with Judaism. And the way I sort of changed that perspective and developed a different answer was both through the support of my friends who kind of carried me through high school when I came out to them, and they were able to support me, and then the wonderful support of my parents, who when I came out to them, my father instantly jumped up and gave me a big hug, and he said, "We're so happy that you're being honest." And then in the same conversation, I told him, "Oh well, I'm not Shomer Negiyah anymore. I'm not abiding by the halacha to not touch woman." And he just gave me this look. He's like, "What?" And I'm like, "Well, you know, it's not really relevant anymore." He's like, "But that's halacha. What are you doing?" So it was the support of both my parents and my friends, especially after I came out, that showed me that I can be out in the Orthodox community. In college, I am out, and I'm one of the leaders in the Jewish community in Chabad and Hillel. And I kind of, the question went away, where it's not, why did God make me gay? It's more, why did the election go this way versus that? Or what's going to be happening at work this week? And like, just regular everyday questions, because it doesn't bother me anymore. It's not such a conflict in my mind of the being gay the sexual identity and the Judaism.
For me, by the time I accepted, I realized for myself that I'm gay. I was at a point then that I was, from seeing the therapist, very happy to be me. It was all about accepting who I am. And so the fact that God made me gay wasn't even a question. It's like, oh, God made me Joanna, cool. But I did have the question for sure, why did God put that text in the Torah against the male homosexual act? And that was a big question. But there were lots of things in the Torah that I don't quite understand, so it wasn't something I grappled with too hard.
I mean, it wasn't a specific problem. Everything was a problem.
Yeah, so exactly, like, so yeah, in the Torah, like, there talks about owning slaves. That's a problem to me. It talks about wiping out all of Amalek, even the babies who haven't done anything because of their parents, and that was also a problem to me. But what's beautiful about Torah is that this brings on discussions of rabbis saying, well, why is it saying this? Well, can we learn from this? What brought this to be here? So for slavery, it could be, one response that felt good for me was that the people of that time that received the Torah were going to be owning slaves, and this just made it a more moral way. Or with wiping out Amalek, a response that was good was that it's not, that it's wipe out the people who are like Amalek, that but from yourself, not literally killing, just the people who are out to completely destroy you, like that you can protect yourself, basically. And just in that way, that we don't say that because the Torah says that wiping out Amalek, that's morality. I think with the same text, we have to separate morality from the text, that just because it's in the Torah doesn't mean that it's not black and white, that it's immoral to be homosexual. I can't get on board with that. And actually hearing that text, that while knowing that who I am, part of who I am, is gay, made me really feel like, well, I don't think the Torah is written by God. And that was part of that whole feeling there.
So you're saying, in a way, the way for you to negotiate the problem was to split off divinity from the Jewish conception of divinity in the text?
So at first I didn't. Like, at first I saw there's plenty of issues, but then this one hit me so personally. It felt like a rejection of who I am, and that was not okay for me. And yeah, from there, I decided I no longer believe the Torah is written by God.
So Judaism got it wrong.
Well, Judaism, there's a lot of, if you look at Judaism throughout the years, first of all, conservative and reform Judaism are a huge part, and they don't necessarily say every single word is from God. And I know Orthodox Jews that don't say that, I know Orthodox Jews that don't say that Noah's Ark actually happened in a literal sense, but that there's many reasons that text could be there without it being the word of God.
Okay, well, we're gonna come back to that. Andrew?
I don't like this question, Elliot. I'm joking, but it sort of reminds me of the questions that often get asked in you go to a Jewish lecture and it's like, why do bad things happen to good people? Why does, you know, and I don't like to ask why God made me gay, because I view it as a blessing. I do believe in the Kabbalistic concept of a soul journey. And in coming out and reconciling that with my Judaism, it's taken an incredible amount of vulnerability, especially working on Bay Street. You know, I was a senior executive at an investment firm. It's not, Bay Street is not generally a pleasant environment to be openly gay. It may be tested, it was a testing ground for orthodoxy for me in terms of what I'd have to deal with. But the notion of being vulnerable and showing courage is something that I continually come up against as I negotiate these identities. And when I think about, you know, it's impossible to know what the path of my soul is, but I suspect something deep in there around working on courage and vulnerability is one of the reasons I'm going through this experience.
But I'm wondering, like, in other words, the God of the Bible seems to have pretty exacting, uncompromising standards, mm-hmm. and a very specific, a set of behavioral boundaries, rewards, punishments, mm-hmm. For compliance and non-compliance. And I'm wondering, how do you reconcile that when you think about heaven or think about praying?
So the God of the Torah certainly has, it's a very frequent reward and punishment type of God in the Torah. And when you look at, when you look at the letters of God's name, the Yud-He, Vav-He, I mean, Kabbalistically, we'd say that these represent four different worlds. The lower He is that reward and punishment God. That's the sort of physical realm where we learn discipline from certain physical acts, whether it's saying a bracha after we get out of the bathroom, or thanking God for clothing the naked, or giving sight to the blind. Those physical acts of discipline, kashrut's another example, becoming conscious in our physical acts, that set us up for our Judaism, because we go through the day doing physical things. But I believe there are three other letters of God's name, just like we don't end the Shacharit service with the morning blessings after getting out of bed. There's the second Kabbalistic world of love, which is the Vav, feeling something greater, feeling a connection to God. And there's the word above, the hay above that Vav, which is the world of knowledge, and knowing that since you've experienced this love for God or another person, how do I contextualize that into my role in the world in terms of doing good? And so what I encounter in Orthodoxy is very much an orthodoxy that seems to get stuck in that lower world of reward and punishment God. And not saying that these physical acts and these disciplines around kashrut or saying a bracha after the bathroom are ways to set up our consciousness so that we vault ourselves into love and tikkun olam and higher levels of transcendence, but the reward and punishment becomes the Judaism in and of itself. And that's a key component of the struggle that I encounter with Orthodoxy, is that I think we should be using that lower world to vault us into something different instead of that being the end in itself.
Okay. So many questions. So if the question is, why did God make me gay? Do I ask myself that? No. The question that I ask myself more, honestly, is why did God make me a woman? Because that honestly, the fact that men say every single day, thank you, Lord, our God, for not making me female, that's offensive to me. So I'm like, well, if he likes men so much, why am I a woman? So, but it definitely is a struggle to not be, to fit into that mainstream. And there's a poem that I read when I was a senior at Stern that totally changed my life. And this poet, her name is Megan Fally. The poem's called God Talks Back. And it's pretty much a letter that God writes to Megan. It's a letter that he writes to her about how he feels about her and about her prayers and just about different things. And I'm just going to read you a tiny bit of it. I'll read it slower. Do you remember the game of telephone? How a chain of girls would pass around one whisper, and by the time it returned to you, your secret was no longer your own. That's what working with messengers and missionaries is like. Even now, this letter will arrive to you in all the wrong dialects, its word sifted. But it's okay, because I know you heard me. Because the entire time you read this, these moments I poured through you like sun floods a window pane, I was real. And when I read that about everybody, about the missionaries and the messengers and things getting messed up, I was like, yep, that makes sense. So I think that God loves me. I think God made me exactly the way I am. I don't think God makes mistakes. Definitely, I'd like to believe I'm not a mistake. That would be horrible. So I think also, you know, some of my like favorite moments are when I'm totally alone and I'm sitting in my room and I'll just concentrate on the idea that God is there with me. And for me, that's very comforting, that God loves me just as much as anybody else if he is deciding to be in the room with me. And so in that same poem, the one Megan wrote, she writes, "As for the prayers, seriously, asking me to make you skinny, again, you've been hounding me for this since 97. I gave you a working heart. I gave you working legs, a ticking heart, a block to run around. Sure, I gave you cupcakes. I also gave you the right to choose." I think at the end of the day, we all have our strengths and weaknesses and points of struggle, and God gives us all the tools that we need to live our best life. So yeah, I'm pretty happy with who I am.
I'm thrilled. I want to get back to something that you said just before, Gidon, because it kind of hung in the air for me. You said that at a certain point you had a conception of God as a torturer, and that went away. I'm sort of interested what replaced it. What's your image now? And when you alluded to Yom Kippur, I mean, for many gay men, Yom Kippur is a very charged moment because in the Mincha prayer you say the Kriya of the Torah, which refers to all the sexual sins in Vayikra, including sex meant between men. And so that's a very painful moment for many gay men if they are in shul listening to that kriya. So I'm wondering what happened, you know, what did it change into for you?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think with the switch for me was somewhat of a realization where I realized that this, me being gay, was not at all an imperfection. It was just another aspect of who I was, and I definitely see it now, as Andrew had said, as one of the great blessings that God gave me. I think it does allow me to have more nuanced understanding, to empathize with other people, and brought a greater vulnerability in how I see the world. The switch, I think, I mean, that's Yom Kippur, and as you said, it's a very challenging time for me being gay, for a lot of other gay friends that I have, and I think it was going through that Yom Kippur, feeling absolutely terrible, going through the Musaf prayer, ending Mincha, feeling crushed on the inside and torn apart. I thought that I just couldn't carry on like this. This wasn't a sustainable way of living for me, a sustainable way of thinking. And the switch in my head from God the torturer to how I see God now, where my davening with him, when I daven, I see it as a conversation, somewhat of a confidant, someone that I do feel that I talk to, and not only during davening, but throughout the day. I wouldn't be able to say what the exact cause of the switch was, but it was a combination of realizing this was absolutely not sustainable for me to either be living like this in this oppressed state of mind with the understanding that the person pulling all the strings was pulling them to hurt me, and that or to just leave, which wasn't an option that I wanted. And I think it kind of just carried me through the last months of school with that mindset. And I remember when I was speaking to my parents about deciding which college to go to, I told them, well, there's a very good chance I'll come out of my freshman year, my first year, not being religious at all anymore, which they were surprised by, and not too happy with, but in the end, I think one of the things that sort of kept me on the path and switched my way of thinking about God was the great acceptance that I received when I came out. Because I saw that I was fearful that once I came out, I'd be shunned. My first week back home in the summer after I graduated and after I came out, I was terrified of going to shul Friday night because I was worried I'd walk in and then everyone would say hello and the rabbi would publicly ask me to leave. And I told myself, if I don't go this week, Friday night, give it a try, I know that for the rest of the summer, I'm just not gonna go to shul. And I ended up going and no one said a thing. They were all congratulating me on graduating from high school and no one mentioned it. And I think it was that acceptance that I received and the love from my friends and my parents that showed me that this outlook that I was having of the situation God placed me in wasn't true. I wasn't that God was giving me this impossible situation, putting me in a spot that I couldn't move, because now it was open to me. I saw that I was still Orthodox, I was still considered myself modern Orthodox, and I was out. And no one was telling me, leave the community. No one was saying, well, when you get to GW, to George Washington, you can't come to Chabad, you can't come to Hillel. And it showed me that the conflict wasn't there anymore. God wasn't actually torturing me. It was just now he was opening up the world.
Except for the one piece, which is the verse, right? So I'm interested, you and Andrew, you have this explicit verse in the Torah, right? V'etzachar lo tishkav mishkveh isha toevet hi. Right? It's not easy to translate, but a man should not lie with another man, so to speak, the lyings of a woman. It is an abomination. The verse doesn't say anything about being gay per se. Right? It doesn't talk about having a homosexual orientation. It doesn't talk about feelings or emotional connections. But it seems unequivocally opposed to a certain kind of sexual act, that of anal penetration between men. At least that's how it was understood by the rabbis of the Talmud. So I'm wondering if you feel, as I'm sure you do, that your orientation is who you are, it's not a choice, it's what you are, then why do you think this form of sexuality is abhorrent to the Torah, and how do you then think about your sexual life in this context? Is it just like, we don't do this one thing, or is this a metaphor for, I shouldn't be doing this at all? Like, how do you absorb that?
I don't know if my parents, when they gave up their front row Raptor seats for tonight, expected me to be on a stage in front of 300 people talking about anal sex. And if anybody straight in the audience wants to come up and answer this question after I'm done about what their favorite positions are, I'm more than open to it. But I think it is an important question because it seems that when anything LGBT in Orthodoxy comes up, it then gets narrowed to G, so the rest of the spectrum is completely dropped, and then the G, the gay part, gets turned into gay sex, and that's what everybody wants to talk about. And I think it exposes this question a complete double standard. To me, the issues are, how do we do tshuva over the countless youth that have been driven into suicide because of the rabbi's stance? How do we keep kids in Yiddishkeit when they're coming out and maintain their sense of dignity? How do we ensure that the rabbis are trained to provide pastoral counseling so that they can deal with this issue instead of ostracizing these people from the community? Because the fact is that when a person is accepted when they come out, their suicide rates are completely normal, average. When they're not accepted, their suicide rates are 8 times higher. And my friend who runs a drop-in center for Orthodox queer youth in New York reports that as part of the intake, what happens is they ask, he's a social worker, and they ask, have you attempted or thought seriously about suicide? And far too frequently, the answer is yes. And so that's my prelude, but I also think it's important to get to a little bit of the question itself. You talk about celibacy or avoiding certain things. I don't know how many of you were at the previous panel, but Rabbi Chaim Rappaport, who is Jonathan Sachs's, or was Jonathan Sachs's advisor on LGBT issues during Sachs's heyday, long beard, black hat, Chabad Lubavitcher. Sorry, Rabbi Rappaport, I misjudged you. I saw his look and I thought, oh God, what's this guy gonna say? And I regret that I judged him in that way, because what he said is that celibacy is virtually impossible. Get it off the table. It is totally ridiculous to be talking about celibacy. The other thing is that, if you want to get really graphic, since you're asking about anal penetration here, the halacha specifically is around anal penetration. But what happens in Orthodoxy is that anything gay gets conflated with that halacha. So there is no halacha against being in a relationship, showing love, having companionship, showing commitment to one another, having a kid. My friends in Boston who are asked not to bring, the gay couple, not to bring their daughter to shul, that's not halacha. Or we can't list you in the shul directory as a couple, that's not halacha. So from answering the question about sex perspective, get celibacy off the table, and then once I have a partner, God willing, one day soon, we'll talk about what we want to do from a sexual perspective. But I think we really need to refocus the Orthodox community on what the issues are here, because lives are on the line. Kids are committing suicide. And the way straight rabbis want to interpret this verse has direct implications tonight, tomorrow, and every day of the week for people's lives. And until we realize that, we're not going to be able to do things properly.
Joanna, the Torah doesn't really address, it seems, lesbianism at all, right? There's nothing there. And even in the Talmud, there's really scant reference.
Yeah.
But regardless of the relative like paucity of sources about this, it's certainly been seen as outside of the normative system. And Miriam, you identify in a sense as almost non-identifiable in the sense of preferring the term Q or questioning. You both grew up Orthodox. You both went to religious day schools here in Toronto. And I'm wondering, did you ever speak to rabbis or teachers or Orthodox figures that you trust regarding your orientation? And what did they say about it to you? Like, what was that? Was there a discourse at all? And what was the discourse like?
Yeah, I didn't say anything about me specifically, personally. First of all, I didn't accept at that time that I liked women, and that would have been way too scary. but I definitely would constantly receive this message of homosexuality being something immoral, and coming from that verse, but it didn't matter. Again, like you said, the verse says nothing about women. That doesn't come till much later. It's even spoken about. I was always given this idea that homosexuality is immoral, and I really think that's what needs to change. That just like we say, I'm bringing up Amalek again, but that we're not saying, oh, it's moral to kill the babies of Amalek. We don't put the word moral with that. It's in the Torah, it's command of God, but that doesn't mean that it's necessarily moral. I think the same way we really need to separate morality from this one line, that this line isn't there, that verse in the Torah doesn't equate that homosexuality is immoral, because that's the idea I was receiving. That's the idea still being received by girls that I know at Olpana today. And that really needs to change.
I want to get clear on what you're saying here. Are you saying that
Judaism does not say this about being gay, or that it does, but it should be kind of disregarded, or
no, not that it should be disregarded, but that there's so many things in the Torah that we don't disregard it. It's part of the Torah, but
we try to understand them more, right? Like, we don't just accept what it says about Amalek. We don't just say, oh yeah, like, God wants us to commit genocide. Like, that's okay.
Yeah.
We're just going to kill everybody. That's totally fine. Like, no problem. No, every single rabbi throughout the generations, everybody is trying to understand, what does that mean that God wants us to commit genocide? What does that mean? Why are we killing all these people? Why is that okay, right? And maybe that wasn't something that the ancient Jews that received the Torah questioned. Maybe that was totally okay. Maybe they were like, yeah, let's go kill people. Like, maybe they were all about that. But now, and not just now, but let's say 1,000 years ago or 1,500, there was already a question of how can this be? How can a moral God, and we say that God is good, how can a good and moral God command this of us? And it's something that we question, and something that our rabbis for the past few have been asking. So I think that what Joanna's trying to say is, we're at a stage now in our life where we, in life of Judaism, right, in the history of Torah, let's say, where maybe this is our moral question. This is something that we need to really try and understand and to put into perspective.
So you see this as kind of the moral question of the age for Jewish life, or one of them anyway.
I definitely think it's one of them. I definitely think it's one of them, 100%.
And to add to that, I really think that this verse, I think this is also a very, it's one of, like a personal type of law to keep. I don't think, like, it's no one's business whether a person is keeping it or not. And we can discuss why it's there, but it shouldn't be a reflection on anyone, basically.
Right. So I agree with you. I'm curious where the domino stops, right? If we historicize mitzvot, and I think what you're talking about is not just relevant to an LGBT discussion, it's the Jewish question of the time, which is, what's the relation between permanence and history? Do we say that was then, this is now, in which case we're historicizing mitzvot, in which case we could historicize all mitzvot? Where is it that we stand up and say, no, that's permanent, that doesn't change? How does that work for you? Like, you don't maybe.
Yeah, well, I think for me, whenever I've had these conversations and people are always like, oh, well, what's next? What else are you going to be taking out? I don't really see it that way. I think every issue and every mitzvah and every conversation kind of has to be taken on its own merits. And I think here, as Andrew very eloquently stated, like, this is an issue that is costing lives. It's interpretation. The speakings that rabbis have made are causing people to both leave the religious community and to take their own life. And I know from personal experience myself, there was a time in high school when I did contemplate suicide as a way of an escape. And I think, I mean, there is precedent for offering explanations for things in the Torah, so we don't literally take the commandment an eye for an eye to go around poking people's eyes out if they do something. And I think I recall from the previous panel, there was the response that was made when for people who are breaking Shabbat, that if someone's now breaking Shabbos, they previously were thrown out of the Orthodox community, weren't considered Jewish or Orthodox, and the rabbi of the time, who I forget his name, but he wrote a response saying that, no, that's not true anymore. Based on how people are living their lives, there is a reason for us to now say that if someone breaks Shabbat, they are not thrown out of the community. They are not going to be discarded as, like, broken goods. And I think now this is a conversation and a law that needs to be looked at and taken into account, the human factor here, that this isn't just, like, person A, person B, person C. These are our brothers, cousins, sisters, everyone around us in our community who's struggling to deal with this. And it's a very real issue that I think has to be addressed. And it wouldn't necessarily extend saying, oh, let's just discard everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, yeah. There are 613 mitzvot. Why? And by the way, how many times is the man shall not lie with man mentioned in the Torah, right? And how many times we talk about Shabbos and treating people with dignity and respect? Like, what's important here?
I mean, I think, so I think that there's, I mean, I have a bunch of things. I feel like I didn't get a chance to answer a bunch of questions, so I'm going to try to get them all in here. But one thing, and I'll say it really fast, because as one of the, I have time? Okay. I was gonna give a lot of background here to why I talk so fast.
Nobody has anything better to do. We're all here.
All righty. Okay. All right. Here we go. Okay. So about what you were just saying, for me, what I understand it as is if I staked my identity, if my entire identity was that I break Shabbat, like that is who I am. I am someone that does not respect Shabbat. That is me. That is everything I am. It would be very, very hard for an Orthodox community. Maybe they would just love me anyway because they'd feel bad for me, like, oh, this poor girl, she doesn't know what Shabbat is, you know, whatever, maybe. But I'm saying in general, if that's my entire identity, it would be very hard for, if my identity is opposed to what God wants for me and from what, then for the community to really accept me, I think that's a complication, right? I have brothers that spend literally Erev Pesach, they will spend hours looking at lettuce over a light to make sure there are no bugs for an entire day looking at lettuce. And to then ask that person to accept me while I completely break a law that they think is very important to them, that is very important to them, that is their entire life, that's something that we also have to be sensitive to, I think. And I think that, which is another reason why I wanted the title of this event to be Identity Matters or Over the Rainbow, because I think there is so much more, I think, that to every person than who they spend their time at night, who they love, their companion, whatever word you want to use, that's just one truth. That's just one thing about me, when there is so much more that I am and that I think is so much more important. So. I definitely don't think that we're supposed to throw anything out that's in the Torah. I think the Torah is magical. I think even the fact that genocide is written in the Torah, it kind of blows my mind in the sense that this is so crucial to the human experience, that genocide, something that's so, so horrible, and you think, oh my God, these Germans, like, they're so messed up. How could they do that? But it's not the Germans. It's God wrote about genocide. Genocide is a part of the human experience. And so I think it's really hard to throw anything... for me to throw anything of the Torah out, but and so I have to respect everybody's viewpoints. But at the same time, if the question was, did I ever speak to any of my teachers about it? Did I ever speak to anybody in the community about it? Did I ever, and the answer is no, never. In fact, the only, and that's, I think that's a huge problem. I think the fact that sexuality and our bodies are so, so taboo and so not talked about is an issue. The only sexual education, my sister didn't want me to use that word, so the only education about my body that I got in religious schools as a kid growing up was in sixth grade, I will never forget, our teacher put a picture on a projector of a cartoon girl on the wall, and then with a red stain in the pelvis region, and she said, one day, you're going to start to bleed, and never pray for it to stop, because one girl did, and she couldn't have children. I swear, so at any time that I get annoyed by my period, I feel guilty. so, but it's a little psychotic, honestly. Like, that's a problem. Like, kids, like, so, or one of my friends, we were just talking about it, they couldn't even talk to each other. Like, friends can't talk to friends about their sex lives. And sometimes that's necessary, and sometimes that's healthy. I mean, very often it's necessary. So I think that part of what Andrew's saying of preventing kids from committing suicide and being like trying to understand them and listen to them and love them and accept them as, like, this is one, you know, I sometimes eat bugs because I don't check my lettuce, and, like, you're not going to hate me forever because of that, even though it says in the Torah, like, a bajillion times not to eat bugs, I think. there's that. one second, let me check my notes, make sure I didn't miss anything. But yeah, I think that we need to educate our kids, demystify this subject, have more conversations, and try our best to make sure that everybody's safe and everybody's still loving God and each other. And
Andrew, I'm going to come back to you now. And I'm perfectly happy to be the villain in the room, but I do feel that you skirted my question. So I'm going to come back at you, and I want to make it much clearer, okay? I don't have any problem. I completely agree that people have to be safe, that suicide is the number one issue. I personally could give a damn what anybody does in their bedroom with anybody else. It's not an issue for me. That's not the point. The point is that there's a difference between saying, why do you obsess about my sexuality? There are other mitzvot out there are other sins. But I don't see there's no advocacy group in public saying, you know, let's break Shabbos. I have the right to break Shabbos. Let's do this. I have the right to break this. Right? So there's a bit of a kind of an intellectual distortion that's taken place here. The issue really is, if you have something, if you're committing to a halachic system which tells you that a central feature of this expression is sinful, right? We like to use other words in modernity, but those aren't the words that the Torah uses. Torah doesn't use words like appropriate and inappropriate. It uses sin, repentance, redemption, atonement. We can like it, we can hate it, but that's what it is. So the harder question is, what do you do with it? That's what I want to know.
I think there are all sorts of examples when I talk to rabbis on this question of historical examples of halacha either being defanged, halacha evolving. You think of Shemitah and the waiving of debts and that whole cycle and things that were put into historical context so that Judaism can work for the masses. This whole notion, opposition to that type of approach that I often hear is that it's a slippery slope. Like, I've honestly heard this, like, okay, so you allow gay sex. What if a man wants to marry his child? Like, what do you do next, right? And it sounds like a joke, but I hear this type of thing very frequently. And I think until we come to a place where halacha is rooted in human dignity, there's a problem. I have a problem with a set of straight rabbis telling me what God made my body for. When you think about straight sex, it's not just rooted in procreation, it's rooted in love. And, you know, God didn't make our mouths, God made our mouths for eating, but we've found all sorts of pleasurable ways to use our mouths, like kissing, right? And so when you think about that in a gay context, and I'm sure the straight people in the room realize that there is something that happens when the boundaries between people disappear and you have that unity of soul. And to tell people that you will never be able to love in this way because of who you are, combined with the fact that it seems like the rabbis don't really it's a little embarrassing, but understand the anus, because there's a lot of pleasure in there, even for straight people who do this kind of stuff. It sounds like that we need to really think about this halacha, not from a slippery slope, oh, what's next because this is voided, but what are we actually talking about here? You know, even little, I read a parsha like Vayera a couple years ago, and the angels go to Sodom, right? And Lot, Lot is asked to sort of by the people in the town to give the men to the people in the town so that the men in the town may know them. The men in Sodom want to rape those angels. And Lot says, no, don't take the men, but take my daughters and you can have your way with them, right? And so I'm not arguing that my sort of view on this is the common orthodox interpretation, but I think, okay, so man cannot lie with men as he lies with woman. Okay, so don't take the men and don't rape the men, but have your way with the women, right? And so there's all sorts of historical context that needs to come into the Torah that doesn't void divinity. I know lots of Orthodox rabbis who say the Torah is divine and it was given by God to the Jews in a time to allow them to progress sort of above the level of the other nations. You know, we talk about taking slaves and raping women. We don't do that these days. We can do better than the Torah. We're supposed to do better than the Torah. And so that's the angle I come at it from.
Right, so you're thinking about, in a sort of serious halachic discussion, a kind of reconfiguring of the equation, right? You've got this verse, but you've also got a whole cluster of moral values talking about loving and nurturance and safety and all that comes with it.
Yeah,
and want to see a reconfiguration of the way that's
whether
understood.
It's a reconfiguration or a discussion, when I talk to people in more right-wing Orthodox circles, it seems like the interpretation of gay is literally like they think I live in San Francisco and go to a bathhouse every night.
Right.
Like literally, this is what it is. It's not I want to start a family, share Torah values with the world, do tikkun olam, use my business for the greater good. That's my Judaism.
Yeah.
And that's not the gay that the rabbis see. Because I think what happens is that, like in many religions, but in Orthodoxy especially, sex is so taboo to begin with. You talk about your experience with sex education, Miriam. It's so taboo to begin with that, like, oh, gosh, what are we going to do with those deviants over there?
Right.
So anything that's associated with, like, anything that could be bad in the Torah, especially related to sex, is, like, so far off the radar that it turns into this really toxic cocktail. So whether I'm saying reconfigure halacha, or at least let's understand the historical context of halacha and who wrote halacha and how that informs our view on how we should treat the LGBT community.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think I'd second a lot of what Andrew had said. And for me personally, a lot of the way or how I think about this and the verse is very much that I feel I have an understanding with God and where I came from seeing him as sort of this aggressive being to one that I have a very good relationship with. And I can't view my God, at least my perspective of God, as having created me and then taken away that option of having that loving family, of being able to go to shul and celebrate a bar mitzvah with my son or something like that. And I kind of view it that there is the historical context that we need to put this verse in, that there was at the time, from my understanding, there was no concept of gay relationships at the time of the Torah, that anal sex between men was used as a domination, a rape, it was a punishment to people. And I think there are a lot of examples throughout the Navi and the Tanakh where there were kings who were punished for doing something to the Jews by like their kingdom taken away and then they were raped. And it's this like domination punishment, whereas that's not what the relationships of the gay relationships of today are. So I do think that even though I have this understanding, I'm just waiting for the rabbis to come along and get on board. And I also wanted to say when you said there's no groups advocating for Shabbat breaking and stuff like that, at least from my understanding and my knowledge, there's no groups that, at least that I'm involved in, that are also advocating for widespread gay male sex. We're advocating, and the work that we do is to have to LGBT inclusivity in communities. We're not necessarily saying like, hey, open up our bedrooms to everyone. We're saying let's stop the youth suicides and let's stop the communities throwing these people out when all they want to do is have a seat at your table and have a spot in your shul.
So can you envision for me, can all of you talk about then what you'd like to see? Like in other words, in shuls, and I know, Andrew, you've been part of a project, and I'd like you to talk about the Welcoming Shuls project. Maybe you can spend a minute talking about that.
Sure. So I'm Eshel's first ever Canadian volunteer with the Welcoming Shuls project. So Eshel is an organization which creates inclusive spaces for LGBT, Orthodox, and traditionally observant Jews and their families who might be struggling with their kids coming out, because we all know there's a process for the parents to go through too when there's a family member who comes out. What the Welcoming Shuls project does is, in a non-judgmental way, asks a series of about 25 questions to Orthodox rabbis around North America. So I go around Toronto and talk to the head rabbis at the leading Orthodox shuls. And the series of questions ranges from, can a gay man get an aliyah? Have you ever met somebody who's transgender? To, if young woman comes out in Orthodox summer camp, how would you treat her? Could she stay? Can a gay man read Torah? Do you want us to help to send you resources if you want to provide pastoral counseling? If the rabbi says, no, a gay man could never lane at this shul, I don't say, oh my gosh, you are a horrible rabbi. What we're trained to do is we keep a very straight, non-judgmental face, straight, no pun intended, non-judgmental face. We take notes, and we keep it in a confidential database so that when people, often youth, come to us in crisis and say, Eshel, I really need a shul where I can just have an aliyah, or that's all I want, or where I'll be able to sponsor Kiddush. Can I go to the shul? Can I go to the shul on Young Street? And we'll say, well, not that one, but the one down on Bathurst might be really good for that. And so we don't publish this information because, frankly, the rabbis don't really wish to talk to us if this is going to be published out in the open, but they're generally very willing to talk to us if it's kept confidential. And one of the things that's happened as a result of it is this side sort of benefit where Orthodox rabbis who have often never really probed into this issue in depth get exposure to observant LGBT people, and they realize that, like, oh, this guy isn't in a bathhouse in San Francisco every night, but he's like a Shabbos-loving, kashrut-keeping Jew who wants to, have a sense of dignity in the community. And interesting things have resulted from that, whether I end up getting aliyah at that shul the next time I'm there, which is like an unintended benefit, or other small signs that these rabbis are taking steps. It doesn't always happen. Sometimes the rabbi has a very stern stance saying, no, you wouldn't be welcome here. There's no place for you in the community. And that's okay too, because it's better that we have this information and send people in crisis to the right shul than to send them to a shul where they might be driven to suicide.
Yeah, and I'm also part of the Welcoming Shuls Project, and I think it's so important today that it exists, because in the past, if someone were to realize that they were gay, there was so much stigma and no chance that they could come out even in the secular world, never mind the Jewish world. But as the secular world is starting to realize that we should accept these people, thank God, the Jewish world is seeing this as well. And in shuls today, people are coming and saying, I do want to be Jewish and LGBTQ. And that's why now the rabbis are dealing with these questions, and it's all the questions we're discussing. And they might not have people to talk to about it, because every community is facing these same questions. And so this Welcoming Shuls Project is really great that it shows them that they're not alone in this, in these questions. They're not the only ones thinking about them. And it's for the community to work together with on. And just to make the changes I want to see, as you asked, is to be accepting. Not just, I don't think the don't ask, don't tell, that way, that doesn't seem enough for me, because that still seems that you're denying of who you are. And I saw the damage that did on my own psyche, and unfortunately on so many people around me. And it's terrible, it's not okay. And so it's great that we're now dealing with these questions.
I think something that I really like about Judaism is, the nuclear family, right? So my question was a while ago, why are Jews successful? Like, how is it that, my friend's grandfather was in Auschwitz and was on the verge of death and now owns a private jet? Like, how does that happen? To me, no, I'm just kidding, but no, but how does that happen? How?
It's definitely not causal. That's one thing I know.
But my answer, maybe one of so my initial answer, my first answer that I came to was Vishinatan Levanacha. We should teach our children, and the idea that no matter where Jewish people go, that they set up their own schools and they set up an education system and they make sure that their kids are getting educated, is going to be why very often Jewish people maybe are more successful. Maybe that's one reason. And I said, okay, that's that's good, that's nice, that makes sense. Okay, cool, I work at Yeshiva University, so very thankful for that place, and my entire Jewish education, so, okay, that makes sense. And then I took it one step further when I realized that very often children that struggle the most are children that are coming from homes, broken homes, where there's only one parent, and it's very, very difficult. And I think that that's why Judaism, and maybe, right, if I'm going to give reasons for God's law, then maybe the reason that Judaism is so insistent on, you know, marriage and a two-family household and also all these protections for women whose husbands pass away, right, all these kinds of things, that is because of Vishnatam Levanacha for the kids, right, for the family. So maybe, and in general, we know that Puruvu is like one of the most important Jewish laws. So for all of those reasons, you would think, mostly the last two, you'd think, well, that's why, you know, homosexuality isn't allowed. Because how are you supposed to have kids? That's the most important Jewish thing, you can't have kids, so therefore you can't be gay. Except that nowadays, that's not true, right? I mean, there are so many ways for a homosexual couple to have a family and to raise a Jewish family. And I think that, I mean, and this is just my own trying to understand things, but you can have a Jewish home and a Jewish family now, even like a biological, your own kid, in a homosexual relationship, which is really cool. So I think that when we're trying to understand those laws in Vayikra, and also like something that really kind of blew my mind about the laws in Vayikra is, first of all, it goes through like all the laws you can't, not all the things you can't do. And so one of them is you can't have relations with your neighbor's wife, which is not incest and it's not homosexual, it's straight and it's there. Because it seems like a bad idea. I don't know if I was so eloquent, but I think that something else that we need to keep in mind is something. So I was practicing this. I was talking about my ideas with different people, making sure that, you know, I was saying the right things, or at least trying my best to say the right things. And somebody was like, somebody had really, really, really homophobic comments for me. A lot of like, people aren't gonna let you be around their kids. And I was like, that's really hurtful. But I thought about it for longer. Should I not be on the panel? What should I not say? What can I not say? What can I say, right? Like all these things that I have to play around with. And then it kind of hit me, two things. One of them is a good friend of mine, he's a psychiatrist, and he was telling me when he was in medical school, one of the patients that came to him was a 17-year-old man that looked like a woman. This man was born without any testosterone receptors, which meant that the testosterone in his body was never able to like match, so he never developed male parts. So he had breasts, and he had hips, and he had a lot of estrogen, but he also had a prostate in his abdomen and a vagina that leads to nowhere or led to nowhere, and he actually had developed prostate cancer because he was a male. And so like a few hundred years ago, 1,000 years ago, this person probably would have died because of the prostate cancer, and nobody would have ever known what was going on. But now we do know. And so that question of what do we do with these human beings? How do we treat these people? Because God doesn't make a mistake, right? God doesn't. So how do we interact with them? That's what first led me to fight for the rights of LGBTQ people, because it just doesn't make sense. And I think that it's really, really important to understand that nobody, like, people are born, like, I think one of the biggest things that we've learned from this panel, I mean, for me, I think this whole experience was we're born the way that we're born, the people that we are, with our, you know, struggles and missions and all the good things and we're born that way. And nobody's changing anybody else, and nobody's going to, hopefully people are going to not impose their own belief systems onto other people and let people come to their... So that's about it. But I think that that's just something to keep in mind on this topic.
Yeah, something that stood out to me that you said when the don't ask, don't tell policy of a lot of shuls was something that I actually have been experiencing almost this entire past year when I've been out on the campaign trail across the U.S. I've been going to a lot of different random little cities and their shuls, and I'm always fearful whenever I go in for Shabbat to make sure that like I'm not wearing a rainbow bracelet or anything that would give me away, because I don't know what their policy would be if they'd throw me out of my lodging, if I'd be allowed to get an aliyah or be davening in their shul. And to me, that message isn't don't ask, don't tell. It's long term, not here. Because it says to me that as soon as I start dating someone, or if I get married, my husband wouldn't be allowed in the shul. It says to me that the birth of my children or a celebration in my family wouldn't be met in the shul's announcements by like Mr. Feen or anything like that. And I think something that I'd like to see in part of the advocacy work that I do is this accepting community where it's not a problem and no one blinks an eye to see me sitting in shul with my husband and our kids at the table and anything like that. It's just a regular Jewish nuclear family.
Just a personal comment for a minute. One of the reasons you see these four people on the panel is that they were courageous enough to want to do it. And this has been a very, very educational experience for me, because when I first conceived of doing this, I actually didn't know how much trouble it would be, because I met a lot of people. There were a lot of people who I asked advice from in terms of getting suggestions for who would want to speak. And that led to a whole series of conversations I had with people, both in person, on the telephone, on Skype. And it was actually it was for me surprisingly painful. It was something that I hadn't experienced, where time after time the person would say to me, I would love to do this, I can't. I'm frightened, or I haven't come out to this person, I haven't come out to that person. So it's not a simple matter just to say, well, if you have a point of view, just come out and say it. It's not a simple matter at all, and that's something I learned. And one of the things that came with it, I also received all sorts of lovely email from all sorts of people with rather colorful comments about what I was doing. Let's say not all of it terribly supportive. Keep the love coming. One note I got, however, was from a lesbian woman here in Toronto. And she attended an Orthodox day school here in Toronto. And she sent me a note saying the following, and I wanted you all to sort of comment on this, because I don't know. Quote, a prominent issue with many Orthodox LGBTQ members is that they are so afraid to come out, they end up marrying someone they do not love and having children with that person, all because they fear what the community will say. Many times the parents of such individuals turn a blind eye or even encourage this. And when I met her in person, she claimed that there are actually a number of from women in the Toronto community who are actually married or in that sort of scene who are gay, and it's created a very, pretty awful tension. And I always wonder, if you're convinced that homosexuality is acquired, would you be comfortable having your daughter marry somebody who's gay if you think it's just something they've put on? I'm wondering if this woman's comments accords with your experience, whether that seems true to you. I have no knowledge, so.
I've definitely met people that are gay and have gotten married to someone of the opposite sex, not someone they were romantically attracted to. And later in life, they've dealt with it, and it's been, they're chill, like, it's you can't hide that. it's a sad thing. And I've also heard of about a rabbi in Israel that sets up gay men with lesbians. So saying, okay, we get that you're, we don't want to put anyone else through marrying you. So you can just marry each other and have a family. And the scary thing is, at first, that actually sounded appealing to me. That, like, oh, what, how great, I can be myself. But you can't be yourself. That's, you're pretending. Your whole life's a sham. And when the children find out, that's really hard news to take. So I'm sad that that exists, and I hope that will change.
Yeah, Joanna, when you mentioned that, I'd also heard about that rabbi. I also thought there was an online service that pairs gay religious people with lesbians. Good shidduch right there, right? Like, I'm being facetious. I think, like, can't we do better than that? Unfortunately, though, I mean, I have what I call Balchuva privilege. Sometimes when I get these questions, or I'm like, what? Like, just get over it, or like, that's not a good solution. But I acknowledge that in Haredi communities and Black Hat communities, or in Bukharian or Syrian or Sephardic communities, that can be very, very traditional, particularly in Israel and in parts of New York. If that solution is going to save someone's life and that's their sort of stepping stone, then I acknowledge that, like, it's not my place to throw that out. If they feel like they are going to be completely ostracized by their community, then maybe that's the solution they have to take. You know, I'll tell you, the reason I use the word Balchuva privilege is because I have friends in New York who have been told when they come out, you don't exist anymore. Don't come back home. You're done. Like, you're out. Like, you are not, you don't exist. Leave. Or how dare you come out? Your sister will never get a shidduch, which is a very, very common one. So then it's put on the person who comes out that they're gonna screw up their whole family's life because they come out. Or I have friends, a number of them, who've been sent to reparative or conversion therapy to fix the gayness, which has been completely outlawed in many countries because, let's call it what it is, it's torture. It's literally torture. And the suicide rates for someone who goes through conversion therapy are astronomical. And so if the alternative is that the person can't, you know, either is in this life of darkness or has lost their entire support infrastructure, because as a Balchuva, my whole support infrastructure wasn't the shul and the yeshiva and the community, right? I came to Judaism, traditional Judaism, on my own. But for people who have that yanked out from under them, where their entire life, their entire being is rooted in the yeshiva, the day school, the shul, the family support infrastructure, if the alternative is yanking that from out from under them and they're on the street or their life is on the line and this is the solution, then, like, I can see it being palatable in those horrible circumstances.
You know, you've each talked in some ways about relationship, even marriage, and I'm wondering how you think about that Jewishly. I mean, you're all familiar with the fact that historically Kiddushin was between a man and a woman, but how do you think about, if you want to get married, would you like to get married Jewishly? And if you want to get married Jewishly, what would that look like?
Go. Yeah, I mean, I definitely would like to get married Jewishly. I think one of the big profound experiences I had this past year, Pesach for me is my favorite Jewish holiday. And I was home, and in my family, the Seders, we go till 3, 4 a.m. We really get into it. And I was thinking, like, how nice it would be to just bring home either a husband or a boyfriend, and he's contributing to the Seder, and, like, my father's like, wow, what a nice Jewish boy. Look at all the insights he's bringing and everything. And I think, and it was also like, I've been to my friends' weddings when they're dancing to the Jewish music and they're walking down the aisle, and there's breaking of the glass and everything. Like I want that for myself. And I think Kiddushin is very obviously a heterosexual structure, and I don't think that for a homosexual wedding it would work. But Rabbi Steve Greenberg, who he's the founder of Eshel and was the first openly gay Orthodox rabbi, he's conducted homosexual weddings and has created a form of religious commitment that takes into account the fact that it's a homosexual couple, but also acknowledges the lifelong commitment to a Jewish life that the couples were wanting to make. And I think for us and for me, that is something that I would want. I don't want to just have a civil, legal wedding. I want to have the big wedding with all of the family and all of my Jewish friends and the shtick and everything that's going on. And I think that we deserve a representation of that commitment from the religion as well.
Yeah.
I'm just going to put you on alert. I'm really going to be finishing up here. If people have questions that they want asked, if you could write them down and somebody will bring them up, I'd appreciate that. Thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah. On the marriage thing, if we believe that God brought us into the world as a manifestation of his love, and the way for us to best emulate God is to continue to show that love to others, some sort of commitment, whether you call it marriage or some other official ceremony, seems like a logical step to take when you're in love with somebody. Even Rabbi Rappaport, the Black Hat Lubavitcher, will say, you know, it's better to be in a monogamous, committed, loving relationship with someone of the same sex than to be jumping from bed to bed. And so whether I want to see like a gay version of the Kiddushin, I don't know, like Kiddushin inherently in the Shever Brachot, like those are inherently straight things, so I don't actually need to see the Kiddushin rewritten, but what I would like to see is some sort of commitment ceremony or form of commitment where Orthodox rabbis or traditional rabbis could acknowledge that two people of the same sex are committing to each other in this way, and then my partner and me then being welcome to go to shul after, whether you call that an Orthodox marriage or some sort of, you know, non-Kiddushin commitment ceremony. I think, you know, it's a logical next step in a loving relationship that makes a lot of sense.
So I'm assuming that what you'd really like is that when you join the shul, they charge you the higher family marriage rate.
Yeah. Right. It's funny. That's one of the questions in the Eshel Welcoming Shuls Project is, you know, if a gay couple who's married elsewhere comes to the shul, could they get the family rate? And the answer is very frequently no. It's actually almost always no. But it would seem illogical to me that as an observant person, when somebody says, okay, well, you can go get married civil, right? Or, you know, just go to court and do it and then go to shul, but don't ask anything from Judaism in terms of marrying you. It flies in the face of my observant life. Like, why would I want to do that? If Yiddishkeit is so core to me, why wouldn't I want a chuppah? Why wouldn't I want to walk down the aisle? Why wouldn't I want to dance, right? So,
yeah. Yeah, I don't know. Weddings have always kind of confused me. I don't know. I mean, I really wanted Alex Clare to sing at my wedding because he is the most beautiful voice ever, and he sings these Jewish songs with, like, the most, like, beautiful, and he's so frum. And I was like, the only way he'll sing at my wedding if I marry a woman is if I'm, like, really giving millions of dollars to, like, Jewish organizations. So I guess that, like, that needs to happen for me. But, yeah, I mean, I would. I think the most important thing for me, really, is to have Shabbat meals with my friends, you know, to be able to host those kinds of things, it's complicated. I just really wanted to, I forgot to do it before, but before Shabbat, I wrote to this person in Israel who is trans, and there are no trans people on this panel, but I sent him the questions because I thought, well, maybe he has a different perspective, and maybe I can share something that he said. Just three lines.
Okay.
And he said there was no way God would want me to live my life hoping for the time to pass so I could die, but I still felt the way I did inside, therefore I must have been created the way I was intentionally, even if I didn't know exactly why yet, because God does not make mistakes. God, as far as I could understand, would definitely prefer me as a whole, happy person, able to do God's work in the world from a place of truth and happiness. And I think that's beautifully written, and the same for me.
I agree with what most of you guys said. About thinking that a Jewish wedding is important because it's such a big part of my life. Why would I not want to bring in my marriage in a Jewish way? At first, though, I felt very much the opposite. I felt Judaism rejects me. Why would I ever have a Jewish wedding? And it was really sad because as my friends have gotten married, I've always loved looking at like, oh, I love this, how they sing that there and this there. And it was really sad to me, like I'm never gonna experience that. But then I turned around and said, no, of course that's something I'd want to experience. I want to have Judaism in my entire life, not just in pieces of it.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so we've, I see there's quite a number of questions here from the floor. We're definitely not. I see.
I guess this was boring for everybody.
You can read all the questions out loud. Maybe that's going to be interesting.
No, we're not going to do that.
This one's a good question, I think.
Yeah, that's... okay.
This is a good one, too.
Right, so there's actually a cluster of questions that seem similar to one another, which is what can straight allies do to support organizations that provide support systems for Jewish youth who are coming out? So there's a whole bunch that are similar to that, so perhaps you can take that.
Yeah, I think one of the most important, or two very important ways, one, how to support the organizations, would be to support them financially. Oftentimes, like Eshel and Torah Motion, things like this, struggle with finding donors because of how taboo the topic may be. And then in turn, people don't want to support it. But I think the second thing is conversations like this with both us on the panel and then you in the audience. We're not able to do a panel in every single shul that we'd like to. But if these conversations and what we've been speaking about, you carry on into your own communities, into your own Shabbos tables, your own friends, that just broadens the conversation and can in turn show how important it is to bring acceptance into each Jewish community and include the LGBT people that you know in your life.
And just to say more on that, I feel oftentimes people just don't speak up because they don't realize there's a reason to speak up. And here's where allies are so amazing and so wonderful that it might be scary, I know for me it would be, for someone who's LGBTQ to approach their school or their shul or any place in their community and to say that there's issues that need to be dealt with. But if allies would come up and actually say that, like, there's people getting hurt right now. I personally know someone that committed suicide, and this isn't okay. We want, if we do, I'm hoping we do, want all Jews to be within our communities, then we really have to speak up. And so, yay, allies.
I think we need to stop skipping Parshas Kedoshim in schools. I think that could be a really interesting way of starting this conversation, maybe not in third grade, maybe not in seventh grade, but maybe in high school or definitely in seminaries and yeshivas. Skipping Parshas Kedoshim seems not
actually, let's talk about that for a second. A couple of people asked that as well. The question of schools, of how this would be approached or not approached in schools. If you're in an Orthodox day school, let's say, How would you approach this topic? What would be the methodology really to convey the sources, the ideologies, the history, like all a number of the things you've talked about? This is actually a fairly complex problem pedagogically.
Yeah, I never went to Jewish day school, so I think you don't can answer it, but in terms of how to approach the subject in schools or with allies, I can address that part more generally, I guess. My answer really has two layers. One is that I think the straight part of the observant community, when there are matters of human dignity, so if a rabbi gets up and calls gay people nothings or deviants or says they should be kicked out of the religion or that they're, you know, worse than animals, because this stuff does still happen. Maybe not as much in modern Orthodoxy, but in right-wing to Haredi Judaism, it's still happening far too frequently. And so people need to stand up right away and say no. Like, lives are on the line, walk out of the drasha, confront the rabbi, and not be afraid of the rabbi, not be afraid. The second thing is that on this sort of slow progress thing where, you know, people say, oh, progress in Orthodoxy is slow, when it's a matter of human dignity and therefore life is on the line right now, I'd say you got to draw the line right away. When it's things about halachic change and more nuanced issues, I think the key is to keep facilitating these conversations, and hopefully next time in a shul, we can't find a shul who's willing to host a panel like this. The discussion's too uncontrolled, right? So we need to bring these conversations into the shuls and right into the community instead of it being on the ancillary fringes.
I think it's super important to talk about, you know, human anatomy and biology and just remind people that this is, there's like, this is human. This is the human, so talk about sexuality and all those things, which you already talked about, like from a medical, like totally, no feelings. Like, let's talk about this in a purely scientific medical kind of way and like inform people and be sensitive to the fact that there more likely than not is a kid in the room that's struggling with this that you may or may not be offending. And then just also, there are so many times that I've like navigated in my life where people have just made insensitive comment jokes that are hurtful. And so kind of just being aware of what you're saying when you're talking to people and the language around certain things that you're saying to make sure that it's inclusive and it's not going to accidentally offend. And that's like with your friends and your peers and at home, and also, of course, as a teacher in a school. And
yeah, I think my sister, she just started high school this past year. She had last week one of these Ask the Rabbi sessions in her, I think it was her Chumash class or something, and she asked the question, well, Rabbi, what do you think about gays and Judaism? And he went on one of these tirades where he was saying, well, it's wrong. He compared it to, I think it was kleptomania, where he said, if someone has an inclination to steal, you put them in therapy. Why shouldn't we be doing the same? And I think this was the very exact type of conversation that we should not be having in schools. And I think it returns to that human dignity factor. There's a lot of things in the Torah that we don't necessarily understand, or we've offered further explanations, such as Amalek, even this week's parsha with the deception that Yaakov used to get the birthright and such. And I think that the conversation should be framed around that. We don't necessarily understand or have an explanation for why this was put in the Torah, but there is numerous things that we can do to still welcome these people in our communities. There's no reason at all why we can't and why I can't live a complete Jewish gay life and be accepted by everyone. And I think that the education in Jewish schools should similarly reflect that view.
And specifically when? Like, when would you start this? At what grade level? How would you introduce this curricularly? Are you talking about high school? What would it be part of? What kind of class would it be part of?
Yeah, I think I would say definitely earlier than high school, and I think my own experience when I came to seventh grade and gay was being used as a slur, and that was my first introduction to the word gay, would show that. I mean, I don't know, I don't want to put a point like saying first, second grade, but I think we're taught human decency very early in school, how to treat each other, sharing is caring, not to insult other people, and I don't think it's wrong to also be teaching that there are different types of family makeups, that not every family has a husband and a wife, and just show that that's just a normal part of life and carry that on through the education system. And I think perhaps in high school you can have a more in-depth conversation about a Jewish thought approach, but I think the constant factor still has to be that human dignity and the human acceptance, and that this is a real effect on people in the class, most likely, who might be internalizing this and then going home and trying to think of ways just out of the life that the community has built for them.
Mm-hmm. I had a question up here, and I actually had a couple of emails asking the same question, which is, how do you feel about the notion that this is just a kind of nisayon, a kind of test that God is giving you? And I'm assuming from the question that passing this test would be sort of to deny your identity. That's a notion that I've heard a lot of. And I guess from the questioner, they'd like to hear your response.
So I've definitely heard that question a lot as well. And I think that that question itself is a reflection on the negative attitudes that our communities have towards gay people or LGBTQ people. That question in itself is saying gay is something that you have to struggle with. And I don't think it needs to be. I think that is actually unnecessary. Why do you have to struggle with who you are? And I think what you're really struggling with is how to fit in into a community that doesn't accept you, and maybe even a workplace that doesn't accept you. That's where the struggle is. And by saying that this is a test of God, that whole premise, I think, needs to change.
Yeah. Can I weigh in for 1 second
sure,
on this one?
Sure.
Yeah, I think I hear this a lot, too, this notion of a test. And while we all have challenges in our life, this test question is often used in the context or with the analogy of like somebody with a disability or who has a parent who passes away, something that they have to get through. And that type of analogy really falls apart when you look at examples of someone who has a disability or, God forbid, has a parent who passes away, and the treatment and the therapy and the counseling and the support that you give them are aimed at making their lives better so that they can be healthy. And when you look at LGBT issues, the sort of treatment or therapy that you give LGBT people drives them out of Yiddishkeit or into taking their lives. And so the notion of a test or a challenge is rooted in something that you can overcome. And given how innate this is, the Torah teaches us, Beitzelem Elohim, right? Like, we're all born in His, made in His image. And so why would I want to overcome something that God made me to be, as the Torah says?
Can I just ask you, because you've raised a couple of times, when you meet rabbis as part of the, Welcoming Shuls Project, and you raise the issue of gay people who feel alienated by the community and the notion of committing suicide and so on, what do they respond when you say that?
I think, first of all, the questionnaire itself it's actually not, though maybe it should be, rooted in any way lecturing or educating the rabbi. Though, if they say, I would never have a gay person at my Shabbos table, I might say, well, you realize, rabbi, it's that kind of attitude that has not only driven people out of Yiddishkeit, but into self-harm. So there's a little bit of that, and maybe there's some learning by the way they, proceed to give me Elliot or little subtle signs that they're learning to accept. But the Welcoming Shuls Project is not really rooted in education as much as data gathering. We're not there to tell them about suicide. We're there to gather data on how the Jewish community is behaving so that we can stream people to the right shuls.
So I tried to understand, right, like my whole question with genocide, I was trying to understand that entire concept, and Judaism helped me. And I was trying to understand, right, like people are born this way, like that boy that I was telling you about who is a male but looked entirely female, and even maybe behaved in certain ways, female, have certain. So what's the deal with them? Where do we find them in the Torah? And in the sense of like being born into a situation that you have no control over, but that is looked down upon by all of Judaism. And I a mamzer. So I don't really know any of the halakhos around that, and I don't know anything about that, but the and I shouldn't have said it, maybe. but there is this idea in Judaism of being born with and having absolutely no control of your surroundings and absolutely no control of how you were born and who you are, and that being, and that forcing you to have challenges. And it seems unfair, and it seems not right, and it seems immoral. And so if anybody could explain to me the moral boundaries of why it's okay to declare somebody a mamzer and why that's okay in Judaism, I think I'll also have a better understanding of all of us. So
I'll be for the next panel, I think.
Can I add something to the education question?
Yeah.
So just to jump back to the question about educating in schools, I think a lot of schools don't actually have policies in place of what teachers should say when kids ask, well, what does Judaism think about homosexuality? A lot of schools just leave it up to the teachers to decide, and that really needs to change, because you can have a wonderful teacher who has pretty negative views and can say some scary things. And that's something that we need to encourage our schools to be coming up with policy that first, number one, promotes dignity, as we've been saying, and overall acceptance, no matter what, and then can start a conversation about the nuances in this topic, and not just this topic, but every topic that teachers are hesitant to talk about. I think it's important to talk, but with the nuance, show that Judaism think there are things that aren't black and white.
Yeah, I want to say actually that I profoundly concur with what you just said, and here I'll speak as an educator for many years, including in this building. There wasn't a year that went by where I wasn't asked about homosexuality, to the point where we created a curriculum about homosexuality, which, you know, wasn't a great curriculum, but at least it was an attempt to talk about something. But it's very illusory to think that if it's not in the curriculum or not part of the school program, that it's not going to come up. All that's going to happen is it's going to come up in a really ad hoc way, where somebody's going to ask a question, and then it's essentially left to the whim of the individual teacher with whatever, wherever they're coming from, whatever they know, whatever their communication style is, as opposed to some sort of structured, thoughtful, deliberate, mindful attempt to create a curriculum which addresses the issue. And obviously it's complicated. It's going to be contoured according to the ideology of the school and so on. But the notion that these things are just not existent if they're not part of the school program is one of the biggest lies in education. Things always come up. And a question not asked is not a question that isn't considered. It just means that the student has sniffed out that this isn't a place that's safe to ask that question. And the questions come anyway, and then you're at the whim of what takes place individually. So I think that is really a big must on the how-to list of education, which is to get it officially into the curriculum, because it's going to get there anyway. I'm going to close. I know that people might have other questions, and you're free to speak to all of these wonderful people separately. I had one question here. I noticed all the panel members are young. Is this significant or chance? It is definitely not chance. That was my idea. I wanted specifically to understand the experience of these young people. I think you've all been magnificent.